Steinberg announced it will stop supporting VST2 in future Steinberg host applications. Now, since this has caused quite a rumble in the VST2 user community, I will share my thoughts on what that will mean for you as a VST user and go in depth on the developer side of this all, since they will be forced to only develop VST3 plugins. First of all, no more VST2 support in future versions of Steinberg hosts, which are Cubase, Nuendo, Wavelab and Dorico, means that Steinberg themselves are taking the final step in the process of discontinuing VST2, which already started a few years ago. The official support and development for the VST 2.4 developer kits has already stopped for quite some time. There are no new licenses issued for developers. So developers who already have the VST 2 developer kit can continue for now. New plugin companies will have it a lot harder, and I noticed some companies have started to drop VST 2 versions as well. For instance, the Nugent Aligner only has a VST 3 version, not a VST 2. This will mean that if you have a DAW which only supports VST 2 and you want new plugins, this will get more and more difficult in the future. Also, since the VST 2 developer kits aren't updated anymore, there will come a point where VST 2 gets too outdated for the then more modern DAWs and computers. If VST 2 to VST 3 wrappers will continue to work remains to be seen. You can question yourself why it took so long for developers to start supporting VST 2. Free. For instance, Sound Toys still don't offer VST 2 plugins. You should know that the first VST 3 version already was launched in 2008, but was mostly looked at with skepticism since VST 2 was going very strong by then, and new functions were added to the VST 2 protocol at request of developers. And in the end, nearly all functions featured in VST 3 were included in VST 2.4. Besides that, many developers already had invested a lot of time and energy in learning to work with the rather frustrating VST 2 developer kits. There was basically no documentation on how to use VST 2 other than some example plugins, which developers could use to start learning. Because of that, sometimes wonky implementations on both host end and plugin end could give all sorts of weird issues and incompatibilities with VST 2, which could actually affect DAW stability. And since Steinberg already has the VST 3 standard rolled out, which has far better documentation and cleaner codebase, it seems understandable why Steinberg is discontinuing VST 2 for real now. So it really seems that if you want to stay up to date with the latest and newest with VST like I do, you will need to install VST 3. If you refuse to go VST 3 for whatever reason, and there might be actually one good reason, simply don't update. Stay with your current working setup. Now, to dive a bit deeper in the developing of VST 3, the VST 3 developer kit is basically an open source project which steadily keeps growing and adds new features and bug fixes, even by outsiders. The developer kits even come with wrappers for audio units, AAX and a few plugin standards more. So if you were under the assumption that the plugin you use which isn't VST 3 is developed separately, there's a big chance it uses a wrapper for the plugin format you use. Basically what Waves has done for years with their Waves shells. Now, plugin developers need to adjust to the VST 3 protocols. It's part of running a software development company. Just like what is happening right now with the adjustments to support Apple M1, which takes pretty long actually, or the adaption of 64-bit support. Why is VST 3 in itself a better protocol than VST 2? That has to do with how it's constructed. VST 2 plugins are constructed of two layers. The editor layer, which is basically everything interface related, so the GUI, and the processor layer, which handles, for instance, the sound processing and the automation and more. These two layers are hardwired to each other and communicate with each other directly. In VST 3, this is done differently, and there are three layers. You still have the editor layer, the GUI, but the processor layer, like it was in VST 2, is now two separate layers. You have the controller layer, which is basically the core of the plugin and has all basic information of the plugin. And a third layer, which is also named processor like in VST 2, but it is there to just handle sound processing. What is the most important is that the three layers in VST3 work independently and exchange their info once in a while. So this means that there is a lot less of a chance to get errors between the layers. If one layer has an error, the other layers won't immediately be affected. VST2 doesn't have this safety net built in. Disadvantages are that in VST3 the communication is much more complex than in VST 2.4, where it was basically point and link. Also, the increased complexity of VST3 also means that there is a bigger chance of little bugs sneaking in. The biggest advantage of VST3 for us as users is obviously the sidechain option. That is why I personally always install VST3 when available. In VST2, this never was implemented properly. Maybe some of you remember you needed to send audio on, for instance, the left channel of a plugin, where the right channel was the sidechained audio, which is very limiting. It is so much easier to do in VST3, which is literally one click on a button and it works on both mono and stereo. One other thing is that multi-channel is way better supported in VST3 than in VST2. Now, what's not so good in VST3 is its MIDI implementation. In VST2, MIDI was very straightforward to do. In VST3, there isn't a real implementation of it. Plugin developers have to use a sort of translator between MIDI and whatever VST3 is using to make it work, which is very finicky and complicated to implement. I believe that the official take by Steinberg is that a host should handle the MIDI and not the plugin, but don't quote me on that. The issue with that is that it requires DAW host developers to properly implement that for VST3, and that is not the case at all right now. So that is something interesting, and developers have to hack around the VST3 protocol to make MIDI work, which is a shame. We can only hope in this regard that with the phasing out of VST2, Steinberg needs to make sure that MIDI implementation in VST3 will improve a lot. If you haven't noticed any difference as a user with your VST3 instrument in comparison to the VST2 version, then it means that the plugin developers do their job right and you can safely use VST3.